car insurance online. Go to the aa.ie.
Largely dry tonight with just isolated showers in the east and south. Overnight lows of 4 degrees down to freezing point. And now you're up to date on News Talk.
Football on Off the Ball
with Paddy Power. Gamble responsibly. Gamblingcare.ie.
Welcome back to Off the Ball Saturday here on News Talk. John Duggan with you through until 5 o'clock. We're joined by the former Republic of Ireland captain David Meyler, football correspondent of the Irish Independent Dan McDonnell, and the broadcaster and journalist Johnny Ward to talk about the beautiful game. Our football coverage with thanks to Paddy Power. For information on responsible gambling, visit gamblingcare.ie. You can text us on 53106 or tweet us at Off the Ball. We're streaming live as well now, so as well as listening on News Talk, you can watch us on the Off The Ball social channels, for Periscope on Twitter at Off The Ball, on YouTube, on Facebook, and on the OTB Sports app for iOS and Android. Search OTB Sports in your app store now to download it if you have not already. Good afternoon, lads. I hope you're well. At this exact time, 63 years ago today, the Munich air disaster happened, 4 minutes past three in 1958. Eight Manchester United players from the Busby Babes would very sadly lose their lives. 23 people in total perished. Those who died, Duncan Edwards, Jeff Bent, Roger Byrne, Mark Jones, Eddie Coleman, David Pegg, Tommy Taylor, and Ireland's Liam Whelan. From Cabra in Dublin, only 22 years of age, I didn't know, Daniel, that he was Manchester United's top scorer the previous season when they won the league title. Very sad. Always to remember Munich, and always important to remember such great footballers.
No, definitely, John, it is. I mean, it's sort of striking. I think the lads at AM had a guest on recently, a Liverpool sort of fan guest, who actually spoke about how, like, even in just, you know, you hear Munich and Hillsborough and stuff getting thrown around and sort of abusive terms, and it's just, like, you know, horrific to think that such a thing could happen, you know. And Munich is a thing that, obviously, I mean, it's slipping further and back into memory as such, you know, in that, you know, the number of people around who really remember what it was like at the time is sort of it's dwindling. I mean, Liam Whelan, as you mentioned, like, would have, I mean, already is and would have gone on to be one of Ireland's greatest ever footballers. His brother Christy passed away last year, who would have been, for so many people, I suppose, a reference point if they're ever doing a piece about you know, Munich or about Manchester or Liam Whelan. And Christy was you know, he was obviously very close to his brother and very much, like, able to articulate the sense of grief and loss and shock and everything that was felt by the family around that time. I mean, one of the things I did a piece, I think, I was checking it there actually just before we came on. It was 4 years ago now. It was around the anniversary of the first ever European Cup game in Ireland, with Shamrock Rovers against Manchester United. It was the Busby Babes. It was in 1957. It was the first time an Irish team had entered the European Cup, and they drew Manchester United. And as it was, I mean, now the Busby Babes, I remember because of the crash in a weird way, but obviously the Busby Babes at the time were like a massive deal, and the game was played in Dalymount Park. And for that piece, I spoke to a couple of the guys who played. I spoke to Christy, and then I spoke to a couple of the guys who played for Rovers that day. Eamon Darcy, the goalkeeper, and Tommy Hamilton, one of the outfield players who'd actually played for Manchester United as a kid, and as a result was good friends with Liam Whelan, and sort of, you know, he was aware and had been in the company of sort of Mark Jones and Tommy Taylor, and had played against Duncan Edwards and stuff. And it just really brought home the human side of it. Like, we just hear about the crash now as a story, but there's the stories that they had were very clear recollection. I mean, Tommy Hamilton, when the news came through that there'd been a crash, he was working, he'd come home and was playing for Rovers, and he went round to the Whelan family home and, like, described this scene at, like, I think 4 p.m. the news came through that Liam had died, and everyone there just dropped to their knees and said the rosary, you know, and it just painted a very sort of, you know, evocative picture of just what an absolutely shocking story this was. I mean, I was delighted that Eamon Darcy, the goalkeeper, took me into a room in his house where he actually had a picture on the wall of, I think, the Rovers team, and he had all this memorabilia from, you know, the Manchester United. Took me up, he had his clippings and cuttings of everything. And obviously, you know, within a year of that game being played, I mean, it was the same campaign, so it was like later in that competition, 6 months later, know, so many of these iconic figures that have passed away. I was actually delighted to see Eamon, who I think he's 87 now, he was on the front page of the Leinster Leader a couple of weeks ago. He's one of the first people to get the vaccine. So he's still going now. He's still going strong. There's a great picture of him. But it is still, like, the more you read about it almost, the more you sort of, it strikes you that it's very important that the memory is preserved. You know, it's very important that the memory of Liam Quelan and the other great players that perished is preserved, because they were an incredible side. And really, like, it is an incredible story, you know, that you think of Bobby Charlton and sort of 10 years later, what some of the survivors went on to do.
Yeah, and the actual Manchester United Twitter page today has got the clock. If anybody who go to Old Trafford, you'd see the clock in the tunnel, which is fixed at 4 minutes past three. And Duncan Edwards was an 18-time capped player for England. He was only 21 years of age. He was a defender. And I think he probably would have been a global football star, Duncan Edwards, if he'd survived the Munich air disaster. And I'd say it was probably a bit like the Beatles coming to Dublin when Manchester United came to Dublin in the late 50s, Dan.
Yeah, no, I mean, that was, it obviously wasn't described that way at the time.
Yeah.
The Beatles were still a couple of years away, but certainly it does seem like, I think, was it young Brian Kerr spoke about being there, or Dunphy maybe spoke about being there, or certainly, like, it was one of these events where I think it was in an afternoon thing, probably to do with floodlights and stuff, and, you know, there was obviously a second leg a week later, over in Manchester, and it definitely was. Like, I went through the archives at the time when I was doing that piece a couple of years ago, and, like, there was that sense at the time of, like, this is an amazing team coming here. You know, that I think they'd been sat next to each other at the draw, whenever the draw was made, because the European Cup was in its infancy then. I mean, that was the whole thing about Munich, that even Manchester United entering the European Cup, like, they were new kids on the block in that context. And there was even a debate about whether they should have done it, because it was such a new competition. So, yeah, I think, I mean, like, obviously League of Ireland crowds were huge then at the time, but it was clear that people knew that this sort of Manchester United team was sprinkled with stardust. Like, they knew what they were seeing. And the fact that Liam Whelan was one of their own, pretty much playing down the road from Cabra, from where he grew up, I mean, it was an event of, like, genuine substance. And of course, what happened subsequently has almost cemented its place in history even more so.
Yeah, and Johnny, you're a big connoisseur of football history. That was a remarkable achievement, that they came back 10 years later and won the European Cup at Wembley with George Best and Bobby Charlton and Dennis Law.
Yeah, and the way that they came out of it and like relatively quickly still became a very, very good team. You know, I suppose my frame of reference is the film United. I was looking there on Wikipedia today. It's 10 years old now, and it was only a 2 million budget film, but it's very hard not to be moved by it and the story that it tells of the young Bobby Charlton. And I suppose what struck me about the crash at the time, or certainly from the film, was that it was so avoidable, and, you know, it was just something that really shouldn't have happened in terrible conditions. And you can imagine being involved with Man United in any shape or form, you know, you'd forever be cemented to the club after that. And I was just minded to look up when Harry Gregg died, and it's nearly a year since he passed. And just, I remember when he passed away, we were talking on the show, and I had to, I suppose, look into his role in it. And he was an absolute hero. These were proper, proper men. You know, he went into a burning plane to rescue three people, including Charlton, I think, who, you know, were probably in real peril at the time. Rescued a woman who had nothing to do with Manchester United, happened to be on the flight. And I remember this time last year when we spoke about Harry, it was one of these things, was kind of like people who came back from the war. They tended not to talk about it, and he didn't. And you can imagine that the effect that it had on those people. And I guess, as Dan was referencing the League of Ireland kind of was probably beginning to wane at that stage. But those who kind of did have a fondness for English football, if you had any sort of fondness for Manchester United at that time, you were basically hooked for life out of loyalty to those who died. And obviously the story of their recovery, which in itself was really incredible. And I would implore people to watch the film if they haven't seen it. And it is nice that it's touched on this time every year because of the enormity of the tragedy. And I think we should always remember Harry Gregg, the Northern Irishman, for the role that he played in it.
Yeah, 63 years ago today, the Munich air disaster. David, hope you're well. Aston Villa beating Arsenal 1-0 in the Premier League today. For the second time in a week, Arsenal have lost. Ollie Watkins with the goal inside 2 minutes. Bertrand Traore was excellent in the build-up to it with an interception. They've signed well, Villa. They've kept Grealish. And last year, they conceded 67 goals in the Premier League. This season, it's only, 24 goals conceded in 21 matches. And a much better outfit now.
No, definitely. I think Dean Smith deserves a lot of credit. I did put something on Twitter, like, he's got to be in the running already, you know, for manager of the season and in the transformation they've had, and you know, since last season. You look at Emi Martinez, who's come in, I believe today was his 11th clean sheet. Then you've got Konsa and Mings, who just look solid. Obviously signing Matty Cash as a right back. You spoke there about Ollie Watkins. You know, players who have been tried and tested in the Championship. And obviously it's a huge step up to go to the Premier League. But I almost felt when they signed those players at the time, certainly Ollie Watkins, I believe they paid about 30 million for him. So we can, you know, stat check that. But it was around that. And at the time I was thinking, is that in case they get relegated? Is it kind of one of those, well, we can sign this fella and bring him in. If it doesn't go well and we go down, we know he's proven in the Championship. He can score goals, get us back to the Premier League. But on the flip side of that, just the way that that team has been, you know, they're so organised, they're well-drilled, and they play with a freedom. It's like, and I like, the prime example would be Tottenham and Chelsea the other night. And I know, JD, you're a Tottenham fan.
Yeah.
But you look at how reserved Tottenham were. And then you look at what you call it. You look at the way Aston Villa just come out and express themselves. Of course, look, Arsenal were always going to throw the kitchen sink in at the last 15, 20 minutes. And they started, you know, to get on top of the game. But, like, Emi Martinez just looks like nothing is going to beat him. Of course, look, he made the blunders last week or whatever. But he's been unbelievable. And I think Dean Smith deserves great credit. And, you know, you can just see Aston Villa. I think it's got to go back to Martin O'Neill's era, you know, where they've had, you know, those amount of wins. I think it's over 10 now in the way they're playing. But they've been a breath of fresh air. And Arsenal just, I don't know what it is with them. You know, they were, I think it was 6 wins out of 7 coming in, you know, to the games against Southampton and that. And they just, there's no consistency with that team. I still think they lack leadership. You know, proper leaders on the pitch. You know, it is unfair to compare them to the great Arsenal teams of old, but they do miss that spine. You know, they've always had like your Steve Ball, Tony Adams, then Martin Keown, Sol Campbell. You know, you have obviously Vieira, Petit, Parler to a certain extent, and of course Henri. But they always had that big spine through the team, and they just look kind of lost. They're almost waiting for, you know, the young boy Saka to produce a moment of magic. But he's such a young kid. He should be. You know, it's almost as if the senior players, the leaders and that, are turning to him to kind of produce some magic. And we've seen that in their performance, especially with Emile Smith-Rowe coming in, that those two are the two that are kind of driving Arsenal on, where it should be, you know, your Lacazette, your Aubameyangs, to a certain extent, Xhaka, Partey. I know he's been injured, but they should be driving the young lads on, and it certainly looks that way. So there are massive concerns with Arsenal, but, you know, Aston Villa have been, you know, superb this season, and they're a joy to watch.
I'm going through the team here, David. Yeah, no Louise, obviously, because of what happened here tonight. Mm. But it's pretty much the team you'd expect Arsenal and Mikel Arteta to field. So it's a little bit of a worry that it's one step forward or two steps forward, one step back with Arsenal all the time. That, as you say, there's no... You think back to the days of Vieira and like just players that be first on the team sheet, and you're kind of looking here. I know Aubameyang came off the bench, but he's the captain, but he wouldn't be a very vociferous captain. Yeah, it's hard to put your finger on how they can improve it and get a consistent run and be challenging for European places again.
I think if you look at it, right, the whole decision with Leno and Martinez, you know, Martinez came in, and I know Leno had been signed and he'd been number one and he got injured, but Martinez came in and he was a breath of fresh air. Do you know what I mean? And they then decide to sell him. They get Matt Ryan on loan from Brighton. It's kind of like, okay, where are you going with that? They get Cedric in from Southampton. It's kind of like, well, he's not playing for Southampton. They sign, obviously, David Luiz, Gabriel, the centre-halves. Look, we all know David Luiz. On his day, he's a fantastic footballer, but there are massive question marks over, you know, his defending. Bellerin has been in talks for years about leaving. At the start of the season, there was talk of Rob Holding going alone to Newcastle. Obviously, he comes in and he's probably been one of their better players. But it's certainly, there's just so much uncertainty in that squad. I think that's the biggest problem. And as much as I think Mikel Arteta is a fantastic manager, I think he'll have a great managerial career. You know, you've seen the lift. But I definitely think there are probably probably 5-6 players that he needs to clear out and get rid of. You know, we've seen all these stories that have been leaked out and all that. There's just something slightly wrong that is holding him back. And once he kind of clears that out and brings in 2-3 players, I think they'll do better and certainly be up, you know, around pushing the top four again.
Okay, we got a text in here in 53106. Hey lads, Villa really doing well this season, might even finish top four. City probably going to go on a run and win the league, but it appears if the other so-called top five are lost in limbo, Aaron in Galway. It is Manchester City against Liverpool tomorrow in the Premier League, and we're going to look at that after the break. We got a goal actually in the game between Newcastle and Southampton at St James's Park. Stephen Goldsmith.
Newcastle 1, Southampton 0. And we have a debut goal for Joe Willock on loan from Arsenal. Sam Maximan made it. He controlled the ball on the left-hand side. He advanced into the Southampton penalty area, cut the ball back. Willock with a lovely little composed finish into the bottom corner. Newcastle 1, Southampton 0.
Preview of Liverpool and Man City after this.
Football on Off the Ball
with Paddy Power. New normal, same old football. Paddy Power. Gamble responsibly. Gamblingcare.ie.
Screen Time.
This week on Screen Time, I talked to actress Zendaya and director Sam Levinson about making Hollywood's first COVID-compliant new movie, Malcolm and Marie, on Netflix. I chat to the director of a fascinating new documentary called Assassins, all about the two women accused of the murder of Kim Jong-un's half-brother. Plus, Sheila Shoiga talks to me about her favourite movie.
Screen Time with John Fardy.
Listen and subscribe to the podcast now or tune in this evening from 6
on News Talk.
Calling all builders, joiners, plasterers and dryliners. Need advice on the right materials for the job? Consider it done. You need them on site and in your hand. Consider it done. You want access to over 10,000 products from the leading construction brands without having to start up the van. Consider it done. There's another way of doing things. ETAG. We talk with you to solve your problem and deliver what you need directly onto site. No second guessing, no seconds wasted. Click ETAG.ie.
Sustainable living? Own it at Experts Electrical Stores nationwide with Bosch. Save water with Bosch iDOS Washing Machine Smart Automatic Detergent Dosing. Save energy with their Perfect Dry Dishwasher Technology. Save waste and keep food fresh for longer with Bosch VitaFresh Fridges. Live like a Bosch at your local Experts Electrical Store and Expert.ie.
For over 25 years, MJ Flood Technology has helped transform organizations. Always innovating, always delivering. Now, as a HPE Gold and preferred partner, we're helping businesses reinvent the way they work with our hybrid cloud solutions. Desktop virtualization allows employees access anywhere from any device without the expensive upfront costs. The future is hybrid. Contact MJ Flood Technology for a free cloud consultation. Visit mjf.ie.
What's safe? What isn't? Things will get back to normal, but some things will never be the same again. Now is the time to protect and clean your air. Made in Ireland, Novarus Home and Business air disinfection devices are safe for all and scientifically proven to kill airborne viruses. Simply plug in and protect for peace of mind 24/7. Novarus. You can't disinfect the air. We can. Order online now at novarus.ie.
VHI Life is more than just a decision to get life insurance. It's a decision to live life with less worry, to not think twice about the financial security of your children, and to give your partner peace of mind. VHI Life. It's a good decision for life. For a quote, call 8090-44444. Terms and conditions apply. VHI Healthcare DAC trading as VHI Healthcare is regulated by the Central Bank of Ireland and is tied to Zurich Life Assurance PLC for VHI Life Term Insurance.
Get even more value with weekly Super Savers at Lidl. Our Irish beef round steak was €3.89, now down to €3. Irish pork loin chops were €3.89, now also only €3. And 1 kilo of rooster potatoes were €1.59, now better than half price at just 49 cent. And make even more savings throughout the store with the Lidl Plus app. Lidl, more for you.
The battle for the Premier League is wide open. Don't miss any of the action with the Now TV Sky Sports and Sports Extra Pass. Now half price for 3 months.
But he's pulled it back instead to Pogba! Oh, what a finish that is!
from Paul Pogba.
Only pay for the games you want. It's your sport on your terms with Now TV. Search Now TV Sports to find out more. 18 plus, content streamed via internet. Standard pricing after 3 months. Further terms apply.
Saturday, breakfast. A walk around the 5K, a nil all in the Premier League. Maybe another walk. Attempt some DIY. Realise you don't have the tools. Order a takeaway. Netflix. Bed. Sunday, breakfast, walk, online shopping, Netflix, another walk, and not so super, super Sunday.
Finally, something exciting to talk about. Dublin Racing Festival, this Saturday and Sunday. Paddy Power, proud sponsors of the Irish Gold Cup.
Please gamble responsibly. 18 plus. See gambleaware.ie.
Football on Off the Ball.
With Paddy Power. Gamble responsibly. Gamblingcare.ie.
Welcome back to Off the Ball Football Saturday. John Duggan with you through until 5 o'clock. Just to get you up to date with the Six Nations, it is now France 24, Italy 3 in Rome. And Honeysuckle, the 11-10 on favourite, has won the Irish champion hurdle for Rachel Blackmore and Henry de Bromhead. William Mullins earlier on with the first three winners of the day, including Shaq and Persois in the big chase, the two-mile chase at the Dublin Racing Festival. So that's what's going on there. Liverpool and Manchester City is live here on News Talk tomorrow on Off the Ball. Exclusive commentary with Nathan Murphy and Damien Delaney. I was reading quotes from Jurgen Klopp that the players wanted to run but couldn't against Brighton, David Meyler. After such a monumental effort to win the Champions League and then to end that 30-year wait for a Premier League title, is it just a case that Liverpool are worn out at the moment?
I suppose it is probably, there is a touch of burnout, yeah. The level that they've played and the consistency they've played at probably for the last three seasons has been phenomenal. Plus, like, look, teams are kind of finding a way to, you know, be solid and resilient against them and, you know, force them into making errors. The times, you know, we saw it there recently with Salah, when you get the ball and you maneuver it and you curl into the top corner, stuff like that, it's not happening all the time. You know, it's been very frustrating to watch Liverpool. But at the same time, they'll still come good. I don't think they'll win the Premier League this year. Of course, look, we're going to touch on the game tomorrow. But yeah, the City have just been outstanding since, you know, they were beaten by Spurs, like everything they've done. And they just look like they're going in the right direction and everything's kind of clicking for them. They're coming into gear. But certainly with Liverpool, they just kind of... I don't have the answers. It's a tough one because I know they've been having conversations behind the scenes. They've been trying to identify the problems. They've been watching games back. It's just not happening for them. You know, but I still feel that they'll be, you know, second. They'll be thereabouts. But I think City just have too much and everything is kind of going in their favour at the moment.
You know Jordan Henderson well, David, obviously, the club skipper. Have you spoken to him about it or...
Vaguely. Yeah, well, at the same time, he's not going to tell me too much because he knows I'm on Taunton TV, and then I'll say I'm not going to sit here and lie. But at the same time, look, it's pretty obvious to see they've been, you know, everybody's had injuries, and I respect that, and that's no excuse. But Liverpool have lost all their centre halves. That's probably the thing, and they've had to shuffle around things. And, you know, the young boys, Williams and Nathan Phillips, you know, coming in, they've done okay in games, they've done well in games, and they've done bad in games. It's a huge responsibility to try and come into, you know, the reigning champions and to be able to, you know, put on that level of performance. You know, you've seen Fabinho, that's just someone who's experienced, someone who, you know, has a know-how of how to play a position. That transition from, you know, the holding midfielder to centre-half isn't too difficult. I've done it myself. You look at Jordan, then there's a case for when he plays centre-half, you know, they're missing his experience in midfield. I did read an interesting piece the other day about Thiago and the signing of Thiago. It's almost, I can't remember who was writing the article now, but they were comparing it kind of to Varane to United. There was no doubting his ability and he was a fantastic footballer. But it's almost as if Thiago doesn't fit the way Liverpool play. So it is an interesting one. It's a bit of a debate. Some people agree, some don't. But I do find it very interesting because since he's kind of broken into the team from, you know, since he recovered from his injury, that's when the bad results have started. And it's just maybe, is it his style of play, the way he plays? But I know your original question was that I've been speaking to Jordan. Yeah, I've spoken to him, but he's not giving me too much information.
Yeah, no worries, lads. City have won 13 in all competitions in a row. This is a chance for them to drive the stake into the Liverpool heart now tomorrow.
Yeah, that's pretty much it, JD. The game is up for Liverpool now at this stage. I mean, the result against Brighton just was, I don't know, they were just so flat. And I remember watching them earlier in the season against Sheffield United at Anfield. And Sheffield United were, I suppose, they were in the early stages of what would be an unbelievably bad run themselves. But Liverpool won the game 2-1, but they were so poor. And I couldn't get over how, like, their pressing game had, they clearly changed their pressing game. And I remember coming away from that night and I was thinking, like, I don't know what it is about Liverpool this season, but they've changed. But after that, they went on a really good run. And maybe it was kind of hiding the fact that Van Dijk was injured. But like when they did beat Palace 7-0, they looked in great shape. And despite the fact that they've had so many injuries and they've had to reshuffle so much, particularly defensively, they were definitely getting away with this. And Salah was scoring goals and everything was fine. But since that game, They do look genuinely tired. That kind of high press intensity, that's not in their game anymore. And I suppose, as has been written about, they've had to change the way they play a bit because they don't have Van Dijk. He's a player that you'd nearly be comfortable enough lead one on one with some of the best players in the world. They don't have that at centre back now, so they have to have an extra cover. Their fullbacks haven't had the season that they would have had. Thiago hasn't been a success. I think he will be a success, but it hasn't worked out for him yet. And Firmino just hasn't really picked up the form. You know, there were echoes of that last season. Mane has been disappointing enough for me as well in the greater part. But I'm with David as well. I think it'll give them a chance to recharge the batteries. The one concern I would have for Liverpool at the moment is now they have a real fight to finish in the top four. Their points average is really, really poor. It's amazing how much they've gone back from last season. And despite the fact that De Bruyne is not playing, I can't see them winning tomorrow the way they're playing. I think City will go there absolutely full of confidence and I think they'll win.
I think we've had this before, and I think Liverpool will stroll into the top four.
Do you think they will?
Yeah, 100%. Yeah, like you still watch Liverpool when they're just, there's no doubt that I'm not sure if the issues they have are like some kind of terminal problem or anything, because there have been sporadic displays in the last couple of weeks where they've turned it on and think, oh, they're back. I just think they're struggling with consistency because. Probably, and I understand that the defensive point is probably a massive part, but there have been one or two of the games as well, like the Burnley and Brighton one, where you're thinking they're almost fatigued mentally in some respects. They just didn't, but I don't think that manifests itself in such a way. Like for them to go out of the top four, they'd have to suffer an unbelievable decline, really. You know,
they wouldn't though, Dan, really, because if you look at Chelsea, we'll say Chelsea are four behind them, and Chelsea are big time on the up. Liverpool are fourth at the moment.
So who are the three teams that would finish ahead of them?
Leicester would probably have to be the other one,
aside from Manchester United. Like,
It'd be Leicester.
It's just hard to see. I'd be more inclined to think they'd finish second still, to be honest. You know, but it's just like. Teams don't win leagues back to back all the time for a reason. Like we've seen City are almost in the Man City era. They've almost been a team who seem to almost win it every second year. You know, like they tend to almost run along that cycle. And I just wonder you're a racing man. Like, you know, they've been to the well too often. You know, and I think maybe it's catching up with them a small bit in certain games where Brighton were at a very good shape and they were very well. You know, they really had a solid plan for that game, and Liverpool just didn't really have the sort of, they just couldn't really break it down.
Second half in that game, they barely had a chance.
No, I know, and listen, they would have. The point has been made on this show before that in previous seasons, it's not just about them sort of picking open the gap, It's also they were generally, as you mentioned, their energy would just strangle the other team, and they don't have that really at the moment, and. I think that's why they're struggling to really produce like a string of performances. But I still think they'll do enough to comfortably finish in the top four. But it's hard to see them winning it, certainly, that's for sure.
City have, 16 clean sheets, David, in the last 20 in all competitions. Only 13 goals conceded in the Premier League, 9 better than everybody else. And Jamie Carragher was writing this morning about Ruben Dias being potentially the leading contender for PFA Player of the Year.
Oh, well, I think, yeah, he has to be. Because, look, like he comes in, you know, from Portugal and whatever, and everyone's raising question marks, kind of saying, look, Guardiola's at it again. He's spending loads more money on another defender, blah, blah, blah. And this young fella, like, I think he's 23 years of age. He's been, you know, phenomenal. So comfortable on the ball. He's strong physically, whether it be in the tackle or in the air. He just looks like a Rolls Royce of a defender. You think about it. There was always these comparisons when company left, like with Laporte and say Van Dijk and the impact. Van Dijk picks up, but this fella's just come in. And then the partnership he's built up with John Stones, who has found this new lease of life. Like Ruben Diaz has been, look, he's been signing the season. He's probably been the player of the season. Of course, the question marks always start arising then if there's somebody scoring loads of goals or some creative player, they usually get the nod, you know, over those players, the defenders. But certainly he has to be in the conversation because, you know, his performances have been incredible.
We've got a goal, Newcastle against Southampton. Stephen Goldsmith.
Newcastle 2, Southampton 0, and the home side double their advantage. It's another unfortunate incident for Southampton because it's an own goal off a defender, and it was made by Sam Maximan again. He got the ball on the left-hand side. He pulled it back to Almiron. His cross was deflected into his own net by Bednarek. He's not having a very good week. Newcastle 2, Southampton 0.
The record is not skipping here. Another goal, Stephen Goldsmith, Newcastle.
Newcastle 2, Southampton 1, and this is the response that the away side needed. We have another debut goal. This time is from Minamino. Bertrand had the ball on the left-hand side. He found the striker inside the penalty area. He turned, hit it left-footed, and it flashed past Carl Darlow in an instant for a consolation so far. Newcastle 2, Southampton 1.
It was a strange one. Minamino never really kind of got going at Liverpool, David. He scored today.
Yeah, it is an interesting one. You know, Johnny touched on there, the Crystal Palace game. That was the last game, you know, he played, like significantly played a large part of the game. And it's kind of, you know, Johnny touched on it, it was kind of that, if you actually sit back and watch the game, Liverpool weren't great in that game. They had 8 shots on target and scored 7 goals. And Minamino did play, and there was just question marks over his performance. Now, I didn't think he was particularly bad, but for some reason, Jurgen seemed to be, you know, off put by him, or wasn't happy with his performance. And he's not featured much. I'm just hoping that, you know, he goes to Southampton. Of course, look, you just touched on there, he scored on his debut here, which is good, but he probably needs that, you know, consistent football and to be able to get to the level that Jurgen will want, because I do think he's a very good player. And I do think there is a place for him in Liverpool squad, but he needs to find some form. And obviously I'm hoping that he can do that at Southampton and then come back to Liverpool in pre-season and kick on.
Gundogan, 4 goals and assist in his last 5 games. The City midfield is purring at the moment, David.
Oh, like you're talking there about, you know, the obviously Diaz being player of the year. Player of the month is out and Gundogan's up for a nomination. He has just been like incredible. I've always been a big admirer. Obviously playing in, you know, midfield. I seen him playing for Dortmund many years ago. Obviously crossed paths with him when I played against Germany. But he's just, he has so much in that he can control the pace of the game. He gets on the ball, he dictates it, you know, he lends it, but it's always clever movement and clever passing. There's always this big thing, you know, where it be commentators, pundits, whoever, play the ball forward. But this lad gets it and he'll move, you know, to the fullback, get it back in order for someone to move and create space. But not only is he kind of the player who, you know, controls the game and runs it, he gets forward and picks up great positions to get himself into areas like you spoke there of his goals and assists. You know, yes, there are penalties, but he does find himself in those pockets where he can get on the end of stuff. And, you know, he's probably a throwback to like a box-to-box midfielder. We don't probably see as many anymore. It's kind of you're either a holding midfielder or you're an attacking midfielder. But he's certainly one that can do both roles. And then, of course, look, Kevin De Bruyne has been their main man for the last few seasons. But in his absence, and even when Kevin was there before he got injured, he really stepped up to the plate and he is the driving force. And I know we'll be, you know, obviously discussing Liverpool and Man City. He's the one that Liverpool need to identify and go after and try and keep him quiet, because he is the one that gets Man City ticking.
53106. Hi, John. One of the lads thinks Liverpool will come second. What are you basing that on, as a matter of interest? At what point do United get mentioned, says David in Cork?
Well, the other David from Cork will say, I support Liverpool, so I'm slightly biased. No, look, United could be there. They could be thereabouts. All I'm going to say is you back your team. I back my team. I think Man City are, you know, strong favourites to win the league over the other two, United and Liverpool. I'm going to say United aren't going to finish second. I'm going to say Liverpool are, like you'll tell me. So it's kind of a thing. But United will be thereabouts. They should finish top 4 comfortably. Unless obviously they pick up injuries to their key players, but certainly I'm going to give Liverpool the nod over them.
Lads, what's your verdict on tomorrow, Liverpool and Man City, Dan and Johnny?
Yeah, you go first then.
Well, I don't know. It's interesting. I've read some interesting stuff during the week about City and how maybe they've been a bit more conservative. I think there was a piece where Gareth Barry, I think, was speaking about it, that they're, you know, that their fullbacks have actually haven't been bombing on as much and have been a bit more reserved and thus leaving them less vulnerable on the counter attack than City might have been previously. And that actually, you know, this is a big factor in why all of a sudden City, for all that you talk about the midfield, it's absolutely purring. Like I would have always enjoyed watching Man City probably more than any team in recent years, you know, just the entertainment value. And while the game against Villa a couple of weeks ago was actually one of the games of the season and there was chances at both ends and stuff, they've actually been quite solid, to be honest. You know, it's a sort of a different type of City. And I suppose it's a question of, like, really they're in a pretty strong position here. Like, what do they need to do? Like, the onus is on Liverpool. Liverpool have to win. Like, they have to win this match, really, to, like, regain some kind of momentum and if they want to. So, I just think City are well capable. Without saying it, like, there's not a chance City are going to shut up shop. Of course they're not. But I think they're very capable of, like, managing the game very well, and I can't see them losing. And you kind of wonder, for all that I'm saying, that I think Liverpool might still finish second. And it's a fair point to say, what are you basing that on? Maybe I just think they're the second best team, you know. But actually, on you know, the points maybe you could maybe argue it. But I just wonder if that desperation for Liverpool to win at City can sort of stay in it, be tight enough, and then if Liverpool really have to go for it, sort of City can pick them off and win it perhaps. But I certainly can't see them losing. Johnny, over to you. Come on, get it. I want Johnny, and then I want David to give us a 3-2 or something like we did for Liverpool United a couple of weeks back.
David tipped 3-2, but he wasn't on about the cup game. He was on about the league game, and
Johnny, I'll jump in before you. I've done some outrageous shouts in that 3-2 and that. So I'm saying tomorrow 1-0 Liverpool, in the hope that there's about 7 or 8 goals. So 1-0 Liverpool.
Yeah, I think that's almost as unlikely as that 3-2 shout at the time you had. Because when you look at the interviews of the game, Robinson and Klopp after the game the other night, like, I can't see how Liverpool go into this game with any real confidence. They had 7 shots on target in the 3 games after the Palace game. The other night against Brighton, they just did not look like mentally or physically, they didn't look like they'd away. They never really looked like getting back into the game, or certainly didn't look like winning the game, having gone 1-0 down. And as Dan says there, City have completely kind of changed the way they play. They've conceded 13 goals and Liverpool have conceded 25. Man United are not that bad defensively, conceded 27. They're a more conservative team now, but the two centre-backs, as you mentioned, they just work very well together. I'd be shocked if Liverpool won this, just with the mentality they have. They know they have to win, but you have one of their best players saying they're not in the title race at the moment, and you've Man City going there full of confidence, thinking even if it's a draw, it's grand, not giving goals away, and they know that, you know, they have a defence here, a Liverpool defence that is clearly shaky and is vulnerable. They'll be confident enough, despite De Bruyne, that they'll get the better of the midfield battle. They have a far better defence than Liverpool at the moment. Liverpool's strike force isn't really firing, and mentally they're kind of shot. So Man City are strong favourites for this with the bookmakers, which is no surprise. I'd be very surprised if they didn't win.
And for that Man United fan, we will talk about your club between now and 5. You've got another hour and 20 minutes to talk about football and plenty of the things to talk about. 5-3-1-6 here. City, as usual, will buy the league. Liverpool don't have the finances to have backup quality players, says one of our texters. Another one, a draw tomorrow, the most likely. City can afford a draw. What do Liverpool need to do tactically tomorrow to win, in your view, David?
I think the big question mark is, obviously, they've signed the 2 centre-halves. Does he play them? Then you're looking at kind of, is Alisson fit? Look, you know, social media has the photos. It looked like Fabinho was back training, Alisson was back training. There'll be obviously massive pluses. If they can get Fabinho back, it pushes Henderson into midfield. I touched on Gundogan there. Like, I know the lads were touching on there. Man City have been like so resilient. But if you look at them now, Pep has almost gone back to what he first did, you know, with the fullbacks kind of coming in, like overloading the midfield. Obviously, they kind of battle up in that 4-3-3 against Liverpool are the same, that the three kind of take on the three. But then City have like introverted fullbacks, like we've seen Kinsella and the form he's been in. Liverpool just need to get a grip of that. And it's a case of, can they get Robertson and Trent Alexander-Arnold bombing forward, get them high up the pitch, that then fullbacks have to be right back in their areas and can't be overloading. Look, it has, certainly with Liverpool's form, they've been, you know, obviously open to counter-attacks, and certainly with City, the style that they play in dominating possession, and like kind of free fluid football, it should be a thrilling game. But Liverpool, they just need to find a way to, you know, to win midfield. If they can get Henderson back in there, would be a huge plus. So it's kind of like, for me, you're kind of waiting to see what the lineups are and what way they decide to go. But flip side of that, you know, you sign these two centre-halves. Like, I've come across the young boy, Ben Davis, before. I think, you know, if you sign him, you're going to have to play him. That's kind of it. And I think he can impact the game. And I think, you know, he's tried and tested in the championship, of course. This is a huge step up. You don't know if he's going to sink or swim, but it's a chance for him to flourish. Jurgen did it years ago, if you remember, with Trent Alexander-Arnold's debut. He started at Old Trafford, and there was a lot of question marks raised over him. Give the boy a chance. And I think, when you sign a player like that, you obviously like him, so put him in, and I hope he does well.
It's now France 45, Italy 3 in the Six Nations. Honeysuckle won the Irish champion hurdle at the Dublin Racing Festival. Shaquan Persois successful earlier on in the big chase, the two-mile chase there. It is Celtic 1, Motherwell 0 in Scotland. And we got a goal in the Premier League in the match between Burnley and Brighton. This is from Adam Dury.
Burnley 0, Brighton 1, and Lewis Dunker scored with Brighton's first chance on target. It came from a corner which was in-swinging into the middle. Dunk was there, unmarked, and he headed towering, and it fell into the bottom left corner of the net. Burnley 0, Brighton 1.
Text in here from Kieran and Sligo on 53106. As a Spurs fan for over 40 years, I've never seen a worse fit for Spurs than Mourinho has been. It should have been clear to Daniel Levy that in recent years, Mourinho's treatment of individual players has been dreadful. He needs a goal the other night, and he just brings on two subs and leaves Bale on the bench. I can't see him making it to the end of the season, and can be just thankful that the bottom three teams are so far adrift, or they'd be in a relegation dogfight on current form. David Meyler, discuss.
I don't think Tottenham will be in a relegation battle. I still think they have enough quality. I think without Harry Kane, they look, it's a bit unfair to say they look lost, but it's the way Harry plays, you know, dropping in to get Bergwijn, Lamella, whoever, Lucas Moura running beyond with Son. Obviously, that partnership was massive with the goals and the assists that they were providing for one another. It's just kind of, there's no one to do what Kane does for them. And that's a problem that Jose's got to, you know, got to do. I think the players do, like, certainly, you know, the way that they were set up against Chelsea, the first half was awful. No, I watched it on BT. If any of you watch it, Jermaine Genius went through points of, like, you know, Højbjerg going getting the ball, but Sissoko not moving. Like, there was a lack of movement from a lot of players to go and receive the ball. That kind of, you know, the biggest thing you will always hear any pundit talking about is courage, and that courage to go, you know, and get on the ball. If someone's up your backside putting pressure on you, do you have the courage to go and take the ball? You know what I mean? When, especially when things aren't going well, and a lot of that hasn't happened. At the moment, when Ndombele is certainly a very gifted midfielder, but he plays his own way, and that's the biggest. It's just the whole Spurs thing. Like, is it a case of they're not buying into what Mourinho wants? Like, he wants them to be solid, but, you know, if you look at Liverpool the last few years, because I've watched a lot of them, Liverpool used to be like that under Klopp. They were very solid. I wouldn't have said they were as deep. But certainly when they counterattacked at speed. Like, Tottenham don't look like that. And they look lost without Harry Kane. Like, obviously, the gentleman there mentioned Gareth Bale. I think that's just been a disaster of a signing. It's not worked out. Like, I had high hopes of Gareth Bale. I played against them in the Premier League, international. Like, there's no doubting. I'll go as far as saying he was a wonderful player. He just doesn't look himself. I don't know what it is. Like, he looked lethargic in the last few games he played, even when I watched him in the FA Cup. You know, he's not the same. A lot of people said, you know, he had that fallout with Zidane. Then the beauty of social media is you get different opinions and different angles. And a lot of Madrid fans were tweeting me, or Spanish people who, you know, obviously watch Real Madrid a lot, were saying Bale's performance was actually really bad for Madrid. Like, he's not the player he was. And know, that's just something that's not worked out. And at the moment, they just look lost.
Yeah, it's two league wins, lads, from 10 in the last 10 matches. And it kind of fits the narrative, doesn't it, about Jose, that he has a good run. Like, Spurs were top of the league before Christmas. And like at Chelsea, it was great. They won a title. Then it all kind of fell apart. At United, they finished second. They won the Europa League. Then it all fell apart. It feeds the narrative that he's yesterday's man, and that even Miguel Delaney was writing about this during the week in The Independent, that there's just a lack of possibly attacking imagination when it comes to Jose's teams. And maybe football has moved on. And this run of form is just fitting that narrative.
Problem like you have is the game the other night, even Chelsea. But listen, Thomas Tuchel's only in the door, but there was certainly a bit more, particularly like the first half. I know Spurs were just poor, but definitely was a bit more pattern already. You could see to what Chelsea were trying to do. The K factor is still huge, and you know, Son in particular really seems to struggle without him. And the sort of that is a bit like the movement between those two is actually a big part of how Spurs operate when things are going well. But it seems like at various stages in this season, like we've been saying, oh, this manager has proved us wrong, or this manager is, you know, is not what he used to be. Like between Lampard and Mourinho, like had that period before Christmas where they were both sort of on a high almost, or Lampard maybe November. And it's but Mourinho, you are going back to probably the original view that a lot of people had, that it wasn't a good fit. And the problem with Mourinho in recent years, as we know, is that when, you know, when things start to go south a small bit, they tend to keep going. You know, like that if it is a situation where maybe, as David suggests, I know he wasn't saying it directly, but maybe the players aren't fully buying into it, and there are particular players. Again, he's talking about Dele Alli again this week, and you just feel like if it's getting a bit, if it's got to the point where he's started to fall out with people, I think it's quite hard for him to regain it. I think it's getting harder for him to regain it, because the broader point with Mourinho is probably maybe just lost that bit of an aura, that sort of that suggestion. Like his reputation went before him so much that people probably assumed he had to be right. Whereas you say now, people just wonder, does he really have the ideas for what they need in 2021? And it just feels like they're on a bit of a spiral.
I think, JD, you know, we should give some credit to Pep Guardiola as well, because as much as he's, you know, he's, if there are first world problems, he has a first world problem in trying to pick that Man City team. But he did change the way they played this season. He probably learned from last season and reacted to the, you know, the situation there. They lost Silva, they changed their game a little bit, and they've become really solid defensively. Where has that been from Jose? I thought the Bale sign just smacked of just idiocy, really. This is a player who was clearly on a downward spiral, who you could even question how much he actually even loved the game anymore. And it looked just one of them signings that if you bring in Bale and it doesn't work out, it kind of undermines the squad a bit. And I didn't see the game of the night. I watched them against Liverpool, and they were so poor. It was unbelievable how second best they were in that game. And bear in mind, this is against a Liverpool team that's been pretty hit and miss at the moment. And I thought Mourinho's been gone for a long time. You know, I remember I was talking to season saying that he had his mojo back, but things have gone completely derailed since then. And I'd agree with you. I think he's yesterday's man. Wherever he goes next, it'll be interesting, but it'll be a step down.
How can you lose it like that? This was a guy who was absolutely sensational manager with Chelsea, and I know he had the money, and I know he had all the signings and everything. But then go to like Porto, won a Champions League, won a treble with Inter Milan, even at Chelsea 5 years ago, came back and won the league. How can it just go south? Is it coaching? Because there's maybe a suggestion out there that he's more of a manager than a coach. Is it his coaching team? Or is it why has Jose kind of gone sour?
Oh, yes, it's $1 million question, isn't it? Like you speak of the highs he had with Porto, Inter Milan, Chelsea. But you look at those squads and those teams, certainly the Chelsea one, which would be more familiar to people. Like, I don't know if you've seen it, but Steve Sidwell was talking about, you know, when Avram Grant came in, the kind of, you know, the leaders in the Chelsea team, your John Terry's, your Frank Lampard's, they drove the dressing room on. I think probably Tottenham are missing a bit of that. Do you know, that next level desire and hunger to be successful. I think Mourinho is trying to bring it into them. You know, majority of us have probably watched the All or Nothing, you know, documentary on them. And he's talking about them being more nastier and dirtier. Tottenham are, they're a nice team. They're nice. You know, there's no ruthlessness. I think, you know, the signing of Højbjerg is he's probably the only dirty one out of them. But, you know, that to roll your sleeves up and, you know, go toe-to-toe against someone, go punch for punch, like against Chelsea, they were off the pace. And I think that's Mourinho's biggest problem. The players probably aren't... It's probably wrong to say that they're not Mourinho players, but it's like he doesn't fit that group or that change room of players the way he wants to be. He wants the world to hate him, do you know what I mean? So he can be successful and, you know, strive in that environment. But it's like Tottenham, like you look at, obviously he took over from Pochettino. Everyone who speaks about Pochettino loves Pochettino. Do you know what I mean? He was the friend, he was the father figure. Under Mourinho, I don't think there's that same, you know, love or feeling with Mourinho. And like you look at, you know, they're crying out for like a kind of creative player. Certainly the Harry Kane is out now. Like you've got Dele Alli, but then there's some, you know, hidden agenda. You might know more than I would, JD, being a Spurs fan, but I can't see how you wouldn't use him. Yeah, look, Dele's performances have been nowhere near what we saw a few years ago, but surely with game time and like regular game time, he could get back to that level. But it is hard to say that he's, you know, he still is a top class manager, but it's a tough one really to kind of pinpoint why it's not, you know, it's not working for him.
Okay, we've got to take a break. David Meyler, Dan McDonnell, Johnny Ward, speaking about social media and trolling and footballers and Man United and Everton after the news at 4. We'll be back after that. Just give you some scores in the Premier League and the Championship as well, and Scotland. We got scores in from, Burnley 0, Brighton 1. It's Newcastle 3, Southampton 1. These are half times in the Premier League earlier. Aston Villa defeating Arsenal by 1-0. Ollie Watkins with the goal for Villa, so Arsenal losing that one. In the Championship full-time, Coventry 0, Watford 0. Half-time, Bournemouth 1, Birmingham 1. Its latest score, Bristol City 0, Cardiff 2. Luton Town 1, Huddersfield Town 0 as a half-time score. It's Middlesbrough 1, Brentford 1. Millwall 1, Sheffield Wednesday 1. Preston 0, Rotherham 1. It's QPR 0, Blackburn Rovers 0, Stoke 0, Reading 0. And Wickham 0, Nottingham Forest 1 in the Championship. And Celtic leading Motherwell by a 0-0 at half-time in the Scottish Premiership. 50-10, France lead Italy in the Six Nations. We're back after the news.
Listen back to your favourite News Talk shows at newstalk.com and on the News Talk app.
Calling all builders, joiners, plasterers and dryliners. Need advice on the right materials for the job? Consider it done. You need them on site and in your hand. Consider it done. You want access to over 10,000 products from the leading construction brands without having to start up the van. Consider it done. There's another way of doing things. ETAG. We talk with you to solve your problem and deliver what you need directly onto site. No second guessing, no seconds wasted. Click ETAG.ie.
Welcome to Go Loud Jazz, the new home for jazz music in all its forms. Big band, bebop, smooth, and everything in between. Featuring a mix of new tunes and famous tracks by legendary artists, from Monk and Davis, Parker and Coltrane, to Ella and Billy. Go Loud Jazz, fascinating rhythms. Download the Go Loud app now for free. Go Loud. Podcasts, radio, and music to your ears.
InsureMyCars.ie.
Make it a really good afternoon and check out the great car insurance discounts at InsureMyCars.ie. Ireland's trusted car insurance specialists. For super family savings, check out
InsureMyCars.ie.
City Financial Marketing Group Limited, trading as InsureMyCars.ie, is regulated by the Central Bank of Ireland.
Omega 3 can play a crucial role in recovery after sport. But did you know not all omega-3s are created equal? Take Manami Platinum. Combining exceptionally pure omega-3 with vitamin D3, Manami Platinum supports muscle recovery, brain function and immune health. Discover the power of omega-3 and vitamin D3. Manami Platinum. Available now at your local health food store or pharmacy.
The UK has left the EU. The HSE continues to work with the Department of Health and other agencies to minimise the impact of Brexit on healthcare in Ireland. For more information on your health services and Brexit, visit hse.ie/Brexit. from the HSE.
From windows and doors to tables and chairs, to kitchen cupboards, skirting and bespoke crafted stairs, for dolls, houses and toys, putting smiles on little ones' faces, and planters and baskets in our beloved green spaces, the clocks, the picture frames that adorn living room walls, the desks for home working and learning in schools, engineered wood panels for imaginative builds, whether practical or playful, Medite makes it real. Join the Medite MDF community at MediteMakesItReal.com.
Boyle Sports now has dozens of new player markets on the Boyle Sports app powered by Opta. Fancy that informed striker? Markets now available on shots, left foot, right foot and headed goals. Or how about total passes, tackles, assists? They're all available on every match. Boyle Sports. This is betting. Gamble responsibly. See gamblingcare.ie 18+.
Let's make today a good day. Let the shutters up and the customers in. Let the team know I couldn't do this without them. Let me learn to let go, to trust. Let me give it my all. Let's do ourselves and the business proud. Right. Let's get to work.
At AIB, we know it takes a certain kind of brave to run a business. We see it and we back it with cash flow solutions tailored to your business needs. Let's see what we can do for your business. AIB, we back brave. Lending criteria, terms and conditions apply. Allied Irish Banks PLC is regulated by the Central Bank of Ireland.
Dundeal has the largest range of premium cars in Ireland from all of Ireland's trusted car dealerships. That's why you will find Leinster's Frank Keane BMW on Dundeal. Stop by and connect with Frank Keane BMW on Dundeal today and they will deal directly and deliver safely to you. Dundeal, for deals to feel great about, from all of Ireland's trusted car dealerships.
The Eason Book Club on the Pat Kenny Show.
This month, Eason has recommended four books for us: The Art of Falling by Danielle McLaughlin, White Ivy by Susie Yang, The Boatman and Other Stories by Billy O'Callaghan. And our Eason Book of the Month for February is The Last Thing to Burn by Will Dean. On an isolated farm in the United Kingdom, a woman is trapped by the monster who kidnapped her. When she discovers that she's pregnant, she resolves to protect her child and plans her escape. But when another woman is brought into the fold on the farm, her plans go awry. Can she save herself, her child, and this innocent woman at the same time? We'll be reviewing the book from cover to cover on Thursday, February the 18th.
The Eason Book Club on The Pat Kenny Show. Sharing book recommendations with book lovers every month.
Do join us and discover more at newstalk.com/Eason's Book Club.
Sign up for Newstalk Extra, our email newsletter straight to your inbox. newstalk.com/extra. Across Ireland. Across Ireland. This is the IMRO Radio Awards National Station of the Year. This is Newstalk.
It's 4 o'clock. Good afternoon, I'm Stephen Burke. It'll be the middle of April before everyone over 70 is vaccinated against COVID-19, according to the head of the HSE. Paul Reid says the original target of the end of March is no longer realistic. The first doses from GPs will be given from February 15th, Monday week, starting with the over 85s. The HSE's Paul Reid says the vaccine drive will take months.
When we look at the supply that we currently have, we now have to carry out the vaccination of this age cohort 70 plus with two vaccines as opposed to three, because we won't be utilising the AstraZeneca. So based on that supply, it will bring us into the middle of April. But we'll see, maybe we are in a position, if we do get further supply or increased supply of the Pfizer or Moderna vaccines, we would of course be able to bring that back earlier.
A woman found dead in a burning car in Cork has been described as a great neighbour and a wonderful mother. Mary O'Keefe, who was in her 70s, was found at a wooded area outside Donerail on Thursday afternoon. Gardaí arrested a 62-year-old man last evening on suspicion of unlawful killing. Ralph Regal from The Independent says Mrs. O'Keefe was very active in her community.
The one thing that came across was this was a woman who, despite being in her 70s, really was living life as if like someone in their 40s. She worked. Volunteered helping out in a kind of a sheltered housing complex. She loved music, she loved dancing, she was hailed as a great neighbour.
The chair of the Oireachtas Children's Committee says she's deeply disappointed that Judge Yvonne Murphy has refused to appear before it to discuss the report into the mother and baby homes. Sinn Féin's Kathleen Function wrote to the chair of the commission last week inviting her to attend on the 16th of February, but was told last night she was unavailable. Deputy Function says it's vital a representative attends the committee to answer their concerns.
Everybody knows that it was nearly 6 years in the making
And, you know, there's anger and frustration over the tone and the content in terms of the language and sort of the attitude, as I describe it, of the report.
And two men arrested over the murder of dissident Republican Danny McLean in Belfast will now be held for questioning throughout the weekend. McLean was shot dead while sitting in his red Audi Q2 on the Cliftonville Road area at 8 o'clock on Tuesday evening. Today, detectives were given another 48 hours to question two men aged 46 and 39 who were arrested on Thursday. They're continuing to appeal for witnesses who are in the area to contact them. It's 2 minutes past four.
News Talk weather.
Thanks to the AA. You can find our best discounts on car insurance online. Go to theaa.ie.
Largely dry tonight with just isolated showers in the east and south. Overnight lows of 4 degrees down to freezing point. And now you're up to date on News Talk.
Football on Off the Ball
with Paddy Power. Gamble responsibly. Gamblingcare.ie.
Welcome back to Off the Ball Saturday here on News Talk. John Duggan with you 3 to 5 o'clock, joined by the former Republic of Ireland captain David Meyler, the football correspondent of the Irish Independent Dan McDonnell, the broadcaster and journalist Johnny Ward, to talk about the beautiful game of football. Football on Off the Ball, thanks to Paddy Power. For information on responsible gambling, visit gamblingcare.ie. You can text us 53106 and tweet us at Off the Ball. As well as listening on News Talk, you can watch us on the social channels for Off the Ball, Periscope on Twitter, YouTube, Facebook, and on the OTB Sports app for iOS and Android. If you haven't downloaded that already, please do so. Such great content on the app, podcasts, news, and video as well. I'm just going to go through some racing news at the Dublin Racing Festival. What a day for Simon Torrens, that young claimer. Drop the Anchor at 8-1 has just won the Ladbrokes Hurdle for Simon and trainer Pat Fahey. Dropped the Anchor. And earlier on, Simon rode A Wave of the Sea to win the Matheson Handicap Chase. Earlier on, Willie Mullins and Paul Tennant winning the first three races, including Shaq and Persois, a very impressive winner of the Ladbrokes Dublin Chase, the Grade 1 there. And the other big Grade 1 on the card today, the Chanel Pharma Irish Champion Hurdle, Honeysuckle. Back-to-back wins for Rachel Blackmore, Henry de Bromhead and Honeysuckle, the 11-10 on favourites. Cheltenham Bound surely for Honeysuckle. The French, well, they've laid down a marker, I think, in the Six Nations. Even although it's against Italy, the weakest team in the competition, but 50 points to 10, France have beaten Italy in Rome today with 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 tries. Teddy Thomas scoring 2 tries for France against Italy. Ireland play Wales tomorrow at 3. We've got the Calcutta Cup game as well. England against Scotland at 4:45 at Twickenham. Some text in here. One word, ego. I don't know who that refers to, whether it's myself, Dan, David or Johnny. I don't know who. I presume it's Jose Mourinho, because most of the texts in here are about Jose. Mourinho lost the plot when Rui Faria left him, says another one of our texters. Great show as always. Myler is the man, says Joe. So praise for David Myler there. Here's another one. My view... do you think the Spurs problem is that Mourinho seems to be extremely difficult to get on with? He seems to destroy the confidence of players wherever he goes. His interjection when someone's been interviewed last year was bizarre. It was like he was trying to bring him down in public. He just seems someone you wouldn't want to play for, says Mim in Cork. Apparently the view of the Spurs players is they like Mourinho and they get on with him. But this is an interesting text from Tom, lads. My view easily dismisses that Mourinho, as he's grown older, his ability to relate to his players as a peer has vanished. I don't think he developed a different means of engaging with players. Essentially, he's become the embarrassing uncle who wants to be cool and who gets angry when his audience don't buy it, David Meyler.
Oh, you know, it's just, you know, people are talking constantly about Mourinho and that. It's just, I still think, you know, he's a manager I would want to have played for. He's definitely one of them that's up there. But you're Tottenham there. It's tough. You know, JD, how do you feel about him? You know, you're the Tottenham fan.
I like Mourinho. 20 trophies. I don't believe success in life goes in straight lines. You're not always going to be successful in life. You'll have your peaks, your troughs, your setbacks. Things will work. Things will not work. Failure. I look at Piers Morgan on the TV doing an amazing job of that Good Morning Britain show. He went to the States, did that CNN show. Was brilliant about gun control, but the audience didn't seem to take to him. Went back to the UK, an absolutely brilliant success in that morning show. Success does not go in straight lines. Jose Mourinho is a legend of football. 20 trophies, winning Champions Leagues with clubs like Porto and Inter Milan. Inter Milan had won Champions League, European Cup in decades before he went there, and he dismantled the Italian dominance of the likes of Juventus and AC. Yeah?
I can see social doing Jose Mourinho is the Piers Morgan of football now. That's like, That's your 15-second clip now.
That's my Andy Warhol moment, lads. That's my 15 seconds of fame.
I'm not sure who the ego is on that one, to be honest, either. You know, that's a tough one.
But the problem, like Pearce is doing well, holding Boris Johnson and all to account. But Jose, I do think the game has changed, and I do think he's more of a manager than a coach. And I just wonder, has he got the coaching? Like, you think about Steve McLaren with Alex Ferguson, you think of like Quiroz with Ferguson, and I wonder, does he have the coaching? Like a young coaches team beside him, just don't know if they, like it's all about good defence and getting the ball to Kane and Son. And I don't know if that cuts it. When you look at the Pochettino team, was brilliant in terms of attacking football at times. Spurs in 2016-17 were an amazing team. They got 86 points. They won all but one of their matches at home. They reached a Champions League final under Pochettino. Daniel Levy made a cardinal error in not giving Pochettino £200 million to revamp the squad. Everybody needs support. Pochettino deserved that support. Didn't get it. Maybe Levy thought Mourinho would get the success with the money, and hasn't happened. That's my rant over.
I was going to say, I think you've been waiting to get that off your chest anyway.
Probably for about 6 months. So.
I don't think we can say anything more on Spurs now, John.
No,
that's the perfect finish.
Yeah. We've spoken too much about Spurs. Just a serious issue, David, and I know you've written about this during the week as well. The issue of abuse on social media. During the week, an 18-year-old from Kerry, Patrick O'Brien, was given the Probation Act and escaped a criminal conviction for racially abusing Ian Rush on social media. Frank Rainey, our correspondent here on News Talk, said on OTBAM yesterday that the judge was constrained under legislation in the construction of a sentence. Ian Wright said he was disappointed by the judgment. Also this week, Aaron Connolly deleted his Twitter account. He believed to have done so after getting abused for missing a chance in the game against Spurs. Look, David, it's Aaron's call if he wants to go off social media. More often than that, it's more trouble than it's worth. But I'm sure, as you've documented, you've got abuse on social media. Do you just think it's because Joe Soap's out there thinking you're fair game because you're a footballer, you're in the public eye and they control you and not be held accountable?
Yes. I think that's a certain level of it, yeah. I think with social media, you open yourself up. That's the big thing, that you give these people access to you. Like, as you said, I wrote an article in the 4-2 talking about my own experience years ago when I played, you know, with Sunderland against Portsmouth. I think a lot of people have messaged me on Twitter because there's been a video going around on Facebook or Twitter or wherever of the fastest, you know, Premier League sending off. I think I'm fifth on the list after the young boy from Southampton. I was sent off. But I had a Facebook page that, you know, when I moved across, it was great to have because I could stay in contact with my friends and my family from back in Ireland. I opened it up, you know, thinking this is great. All Sunderland fans, I played in the reserve team and we'd won the reserve league. So it was fantastic. And we always got big crowds and, you know, they'd be messaging on you saying, well done, you're going to be the next first team player. And, you know, I was 19 years of age. I thought it was brilliant. And then I broke into the first team and it was great again. And then I was sent off, which was the first time I had a serious kind of issue. And by God, was I attacked. Like thousands upon thousands of messages, like filled with all different types of abuse. And I remember, you know, I confided in my father. I spoke to him and he said, why do you need it? What's it for? And that is the big thing, you know, and like you touched on Aaron Connolly deleting his Twitter. You know, I know Kevin Doyle. Kevin was on speaking about it and he kind of felt it was immature. But I admire Aaron for being able to, you know, certainly at his age, being able to step away from social media. Because nowadays, like anyone can tweet someone. I could tweet whoever you want to Cristiano Ronaldo and he might see it. That's the thing. He might see it. And, you know, social media is a platform for people to be able to get at other people. And, you know, I started, you know, playing a lot of FIFA a few years ago. That became a big thing. I got, you know, hundreds of messages every week saying, oh, you're this, that type particular footballer. And it would go on and on and on and on. And it is very tough. You know, you look at the prime example. I'll use an example of Jesse Lingard. Jesse Lingard's been through a horrific probably 12 to 16 months in terms of what's gone on in his life outside of football. But yet people see this young lad, well, he's not young. There's always that thing with Jesse being young, but you know, he's playing for Manchester United, one of the biggest clubs in the world, one of the biggest social media followings, everything. Their fans are passionate, you know, they're so used to success. And Jesse's having an awful time off the pitch. But he's been bombarded with abuse constantly for, you know, whether it be his dancing. That's just Jesse. If you don't, like, I think anyone would know what Jesse Lingard is. You know, he's this bubbly fresh air, a great lad. I've met Jesse 20, 30 times. Fantastic young fella. He's been through an awful time. And people, of course, look, Jesse never spoke about it. I imagine, well, I saw an interview he did where he said he spoke to the club about, you know, his issues off the field. And people didn't know that, but they constantly abused him. Can you imagine what it's like, right, for a lad who's, you know, living his dream, playing for Manchester United? Yes, he's been paid thousands upon thousands a week, right? But he's going home. His mother and father were going through difficult circumstances. He then was kind of like the sole care of his younger brother and sister. He had his own child of his own. And he's getting so much hatred online. Do you imagine how that, you know, if you put that into perspective, what he's like? And we're not talking, you know, about 5, 6, 7 messages. You know what I mean? There's, you know, Manchester United fans getting on his back. Then, of course, you'll have Manchester City fans, Liverpool fans. You'll have all types of young boys and girls, was mostly boys, you know, abusing him. And they don't, you never stop to think, like, how does that person feel or what are they going through? It is a very unique thing. It's an endless argument and debate that can go on forever. But the big thing that it all boils down to, these social media companies, your Facebooks, your Twitters, your Instagrams, your TikToks, they need to be held responsible. Like you touched on the Ian Wright thing. This young lad lost a game of FIFA and he felt it was okay to racially abuse Ian Wright. That's not acceptable. You know, it's 2021. You know, it's such an endless argument that this stuff like this shouldn't happen. And he should have been punished. I don't know what the punishment should have been, but he should have been. They should have made an example of him. You know, and I like, if his mother or father hear this, it's tough to hear, but they should have. You know, it's not your fault that this young fella felt that that was appropriate. But it's look, I could go on all day talking about this. I'll leave the other lads give their opinions.
Does it wear you down, David? Does it wear you down? Do you think to yourself, you know what, this is more hassle than it's worth?
Oh, 100%. There's been times I played games where, you know, you score and then you're onto the social media person at the club or, you know, the media officer and you're like, can you get me photos off the photographer? You get the photos, you post them and everyone's like, oh, Dave, you're the best. You know, you're the best at midfielder to ever play for Hull, whoever it was, Hull, Sunderland, Coventry, Reading, whatever. Then when you lose, on the flip side of that, the abuse. And the thing that crept in to me in my early 20s was I started to read those comments and start going, like, obviously, I can't use some of the derogatory terms that were used. I used to read them and kind of go, maybe he's right. Maybe I am awful. Maybe I should, you know, not play. Or you start to, you know, second guess yourself and you start to doubt yourself and whatever. It was only as I kind of got older and kind of like matured a bit more that I was kind of thinking, like, I had the example around the time the kind of penny dropped with me was I played a game with Hull when I just signed. And I remember my dad had flown over for the game. And after the game, I thought I played well. Came into the change room. Steve Bruce ranted and raved about my performance, sat down with me and blah, blah, blah. And I remember I went out after. I used to always go out and, you know, spend 10, 15 minutes with my dad, chit-chatting about the game. We'd run over everything. And my dad battered me for my performance. And he said, you know, you could have done this, you could have done that, you could have done more, you should have been in the box here, you should have done this, you should have stopped that pass, you should have stopped that cross. And he went over everything. And it was a real wake-up call for the pair of us, in the sense that my father, someone who I respect, trust, and no doubt he'll see this, but someone whose opinion I would really value, didn't actually matter. Because at the end of the day, my manager was really happy with my performance and he was going to pick me again next week, regardless of what anyone thought. And then I started to think, like, my own father's opinion doesn't matter as much as the manager's. And then I started to realize, like, these 16, 17, 18 year olds who were attacking me, it doesn't really, you know, bother me now. Because I was like, as long as my manager's happy, then I don't really, everyone else is irrelevant in my mind. And then, like, me and my dad then spoke about it over a pint and we were chatting about it. And I said, but you're coming to the game to watch me. Like, my dad was coming to pick every single positive and negative. I said, whereas the manager's watching a collective group. Like, of course, look, my dad wanted to, you know, wanted me to push on and do better and be successful. But I said, you're nitpicking at every small detail. I said, you're your own manager. You know what I mean? He's been manager of Kerry, Wexford, Cork, senior hurlers. I said, do you nitpick on one person or do you look at the collective group of, you know, obviously the starting 15, if you make three or four substitutions, whatever, you look at the collective group. In this instance, you're just nitpicking on me. And that was really the moment then that I started to think, like, I wasn't then bothered what people said on social media. You know, so I stayed on it. But I know it has deeply affected other people, like other footballers, and has affected their performances.
Well said, David. Well said. It's almost like, guys, what fans think they can say in the terraces, they can bring it online. And as David said there, and social media companies need to trace these people, and there needs to be consequences for them.
Which, just before the lads speak to you, just something I want to add. It's fine. Like, we can talk, right? You support Tottenham, I support Liverpool. Those are the teams we grew up supporting. Like, if Tottenham were playing Liverpool this afternoon, I might say, oh, we're going to hammer ye, you're going to hammer me. Yeah. There's that bit of, you know, almost banter. But then on social media, it's the phrase we used to use in football was Tenerife and 11 reef. You go on holidays to Tenerife, I go to 11 reef. Everyone's trying to go one better. And then it gets personal. And then, like, I've posted photos of my children, especially my daughter who turned 5 a few weeks ago. And people have made references about her, and you kind of think, what kind of kick are you trying to get out of this?
That's sickening.
You know, it is. And I think one day I hope that you grow up, you get married, you have your own children, and then you stop to think, imagine somebody passed comment on your child, how you'd feel. And like you said there, these social media companies have to be held responsible.
Yeah, it's gone to another. It feels like we're sort of reaching a sort of a reckoning of some description. I mean, I know this has always been there, and that, you know, that abuse has always been there. But obviously, you know, social media has evolved. I mean, it's gone from, you know, to sort of Instagram, and you know, I think there's messaging can be open within that, and it seems like there's a lot of sort of bad messages sent through that way. Like, you know, social media and football, like, you know, initially, like, it was viewed in some respects as a very positive thing for footballers. If you remember at the start, almost they could control their own message, they could control their own brand. And there's no doubt that some, like, have used it very well. You know, they got offered all sorts of, you know, good stuff through it. And, like, you know, it felt like it was almost a means for players. They could do their communication that way. And like, that was a phase. And sometimes some of this is almost like reflective of societal stuff now, that, like, what's most shocking about some of this stuff, and not to speak about a specific case, but a lot of the cases, that is, like, you know, teenagers, like, young teenagers who have grown up only probably ever having social media, if you know what I mean, that this is like their existence. And clearly their definition of the boundaries is warped. Like, it's absolutely crazy. And it's got to the point where, as I said, where social media and football initially, like, and sport, and like, you know, it was almost viewed as a great thing. It's sort of flipping around now to the point where we're seeing more and more cases of stuff being reported. Maybe people just feel more empowered to report stuff now as well, too. I don't know if that's possibly the case as well. But it's coming to the stage where you may see more people follow, I think, the Aaron Connolly route, you know, of just coming off it completely, until these social media companies get to the point whereby they are willing to go a bit further in terms of, you know, verification processes or whatever you need to have an active account. Now, like, as ever with all these things, like, there should be sort of, you know, there should be sort of ethical reasons for doing stuff, but often it can be sort of financial or other type of pressures that lead to a proper debate and discussion around it. And that's where something needs to happen, because it's sort of gone to another, like, definitely it's gone to a sort of another level now, really, in some of the stuff that we're hearing. But, like, a lot of it is, like, it is sort of societal stuff, education, everything else, all the stuff that we mentioned when we discuss, say, racism generally, and stuff that happens in the stands. You know, is it a football problem or is it a societal problem? It's often a societal problem, but football is a means for people to express it. And I don't know where it goes. You know, I find it hard to condemn a player who takes himself off it. Like, you know, again, 19-year-old footballers now, you know, they've also grown up, as I mentioned, with social media being something that's like a huge part of their identity and existence. Aaron Connolly is someone who would have been very active on it. So naturally, you know, he's probably paying attention to it when things are going well. And once it's easy to judge someone, say, oh, he shouldn't be doing that, he shouldn't be letting that get to him. But like a lot of people who know, like teenagers now, will see that that's how they live so their lives. So it's very hard for them actually to step back and distance themselves from it completely. So I don't know where it goes. Like, it's a sort of a roundabout discussion, but it sort of feels that the discourse has got even more toxic now. And you sort of feel like there's a tipping point here that, like, we don't need something terrible to happen before, you know, before something is done about it. So I don't know where, what type of pressure, is it a PFA, is it a union thing or something for players? Because if players took themselves off all of these mediums completely, it would damage these mediums too, because obviously there's a circular thing in terms of their presence and what it does for those platforms too. So it feels like something needs to be done, a proper discussion about it, because there's instances popping up all the time now. It's not just isolated events.
Twitter's valued at $30 billion. Taking Trump off Twitter has cost Twitter 10% of that. It's convenient with the new administration in America that Trump has been, oh, it's suddenly a real issue now, what he's been posting. And I think that the best way we can deal with this is to continue to talk about it and continue to highlight how unacceptable it is, and to continue to hammer home with a platform that guys, Twitter, Facebook, all these companies, you've got to regulate this. I don't know what how you idea it or whatever in terms of privacy and all that kind of thing, but governments and social media companies need to get together and sort this out. I know it's happened in the UK. They've met some footballers, the British Oliver Dowden, their culture secretary. And Marcus Rashford, what he's been doing on social media has been brilliant, using his influence as a positive voice to actually change people's lives, David, for the better. So that's the great side of it. But I just think it's almost like, as I said at the very start, that people are they're treating human beings not like human beings. And it's whatever you want to say is okay. And you can say, if you said it on the street, it'd be a problem. And that's the crazy, it's absolutely crazy.
Yeah, and that's the thing. It's that, you know, inverted commas, keyboard warriors. You know, these people who come and they abuse people online. I know 10 of them wouldn't say it to you. You know, that's the thing. But because you're behind a phone screen or a laptop or an iPad, that you can, you know, you can think you can get away with it. They're like that. When you talk about the punishment or what to do, I don't know what it is, but probably one start would be every account needs to be verified. You know, not like as in email. You know, you've got to give certain information that you can't. You have to be then held responsible if you make remarks. Like, use the example of Marcus Rashford. What he did was phenomenal, which is like is breathtaking. You know, all those young, you know, boys and girls across the UK, you know, who are struggling for food. Marcus goes out and, you know, makes the government U-turn on their decision. But then he's then hit with abuse, like concentrating football. Like, what part of that, when whoever those people are, when you're typing, this young man has given food to so many different families that have been struggling during this pandemic that, you know, regardless if he stopped playing football and did it or if he continues playing football and did it, like, that is phenomenal work. But then he's hit with abuse time after time. And if he doesn't have a good performance with Manchester United, they're saying, oh, you care too much about feeding people and all this. Like, it's just mind-blowing. I just can't understand it. But I remember I was on here ages ago and I said, the popular thing nowadays is to be negative. It's kind of the culture of the, you know, the 21st century that everyone just wants to be negative. Like, in the article I wrote, I could now tweet at this very moment, I think Kevin De Bruyne is better than Bruno Fernandes. And I will be hit with people who agree with me, disagree with me, and then I will just get a series of abuse for no apparent reason. But that is just my opinion. And it is, the social media, it's tough, because the only advice I have for young boys and girls is, if you are on there, that, you know, you might think it's great getting your likes or your retweets and that, but you must be prepared that if it doesn't go, like, you're going to be hit with a lot of abuse.
Okay, we've got to take a break. David Meyler, Dan McDonnell, Johnny Ward, we're back after this.
Football on Off the Ball
with Paddy Power. New normal, same old football. Paddy Power. Gamble responsibly. Gamblingcare.ie.
Calling all builders, joiners, plasterers and dryliners. Need advice on the right materials for the job? Consider it done. You need them on site and in your hand. Consider it done. You want access to over 10,000 products from the leading construction brands without having to start up the van. Consider it done. There's another way of doing things. ETAG. We talk with you to solve your problem and deliver what you need directly onto site. No second guessing, no seconds wasted. Click ETAG.ie.
InsureMyCars.ie.
Make it a really good afternoon and check out the great car insurance discounts at InsureMyCars.ie. Ireland's trusted car insurance specialists. For super family savings, check out
InsureMyCars.ie.
City Financial Marketing Group Limited, trading as InsureMyCars.ie, is regulated by the Central Bank of Ireland.
When you get enough people together, you can achieve almost anything. Send someone like me into space or create change on the ground. People power, strength in numbers, whatever you want to call it, it works.
Together with over 1 million homes and businesses already with Electric Ireland, we're making changes for a brighter energy future. Be part of the change at electricireland.ie.
Looking to upgrade your van or pickup? The Ford Upgrade and Save promotion can help you do just that. Save up to €6,500 and future-proof your business. There's the eco-driven Ford Transit and Transit Custom, with mild hybrid and plug-in hybrid powertrains. And the 2020 International Pickup of the Year Ford Ranger. All tough, all reliable, all capable. All yours for less. Search Upgrade and Save or text Ford to 50015 and we'll arrange a call with your local Ford dealer. Texts cost a standard rate. Vehicles must be registered by February 28th. Terms and conditions apply. See Ford.ie for full details.
On your phone, it's just a video of a garden kickabout. Yes. But on a new Samsung Galaxy S21, it's an epic sporting moment captured 14 different ways using single-take technology. At once, a stunning portrait of a stricken keeper, a flurry of garden gasps, a heroic close-up of a determined striker, all ready to share for the glory of endless likes. The new Samsung Galaxy S21 Plus 5G. Made for the epic in every day. Available now.
Come on, best of three?
Here's another great offer from Aldi. Our Grow with Aldi program in association with Bord Bia, now in its fourth year. It offers new Irish producers the golden opportunity to supply Aldi's 145 stores with anything, from fresh cream to face cream. After all, it's not just food products we're interested in. It's great news for customers, because when you shop at Aldi, you're supporting local suppliers too. Find out more at aldi.ie/grow. Aldi, every day Irish, every day amazing.
Saturday, breakfast, a walk around the 5K, a nil all in the Premier League, maybe another walk, attempt some DIY, realise you don't have the tools, order a takeaway, Netflix, bed. Sunday, breakfast, walk, online shopping, Netflix, another walk, a not so super, super Sunday.
Finally, something exciting to talk about. Dublin Racing Festival, this Saturday and Sunday. Paddy Power, proud sponsors of the Irish Gold Cup.
Please gamble responsibly. 18 plus. See gambleaware.ie.
Football on Off the Ball
with Paddy Power. Minimal contact in stadiums shouldn't stop the usual suspects from going down. Gamble responsibly. Gamblingcare.ie.
This is Off the Ball Saturday on News Talk. John Duggan with you through until 5 o'clock with David Meyler, Johnny Ward and Dan McDonnell speaking about football. Just to let you know, with Celtic 2, Motherwell 1 now. Welch and Edward with the goals at Parkhead for Celtic. France thumping Italy by 50 points to 10 on the opening day of the Six Nations. Not long to go now before England and Scotland kick off. Jeff Hendrick has been sent off in the Premier League for Newcastle. They lead Southampton 3-2 at St James's Park. It is Burnley 1, Brighton 1 with about 20 minutes to go in those matches. Aston Villa earlier beat Arsenal by a goal to nil. Half 5 kickoff, Fulham against West Ham. 8 o'clock start, Manchester United against Everton. And in the Championship, full time earlier, Coventry 0, Watford 0. At the moment, Bournemouth 2, Birmingham 2. It's Bristol City, Cardiff City 2, Mick McCarthy's Cardiff. Luton Town 1, Huddersfield Town 0 is the latest score. It's Middlesbrough 1, Brentford 3. Millwall leading Sheffield Wednesday by 3-1. At Preston North End 1, Rotherham 2. QPR 1, Blackburn 0. Stoke 0, Reading 0. And Wickham 0, Nottingham Forest 2. Johnny, during the week, Aaron McAniff left Shamrock Rovers to go to Hearts. A, is it a good move for Aaron? And B, is it a worry for Rovers having lost now McAniff and Jack Byrne?
Yeah, it really is. You know, they've gone from a position where, you know, I've spoken to a couple of people within the game who are sort of predicting that they'd walk the league, to a position now where, like, regardless of what you think, you lose Jack Byrne and Aaron McAniff. And I know all the talk would be about Jack Byrne, but Aaron McAniff nearly got into the Ireland, you know, got into the Ireland squad last year, and he's really, really important to the way they play. I remember I went to a Rovers training session. Honestly, I have no concept of time now. It might have been last year. It might have been 3 years ago. The whole pandemic has just made me lose the entire concept. But they were doing these drills, which I'm sure David is well familiar with, where you're basically running. You're running 20 yards and back over 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 and back. And eventually, players get tired and you expect the goalkeeper to be one of the first ones to K or whatever. But Aaron McAniff was just like the Duracell bunny. He just didn't stop. And when he was at Derry, he was probably, I think Dan would agree here, is probably known as more of a kind of a flashy player, with really good technical ability, would produce some good goals. But he came into a Shamrock Rovers team where, you know, there was a lot of quality there in that midfield, and he had to kind of accept a different role. And with Gary O'Neill as well, a really important player for them, who I thought has had an outstanding time with Shamrock Rovers. So McAniff came in and just massive energy. You wouldn't sort of notice a lot of the time maybe the game that he's having, but he's been hugely important for them. And if you consider that Jack Byrne is gone, he's kind of been replaced by Danny Mandreou, who was basically let go by Bohemians. They didn't really want to keep him. So that's not certain to work out. They've lost Aaron McAniff, who's hugely important. Greg Bulger has moved on, which is fair enough. He's getting on a bit. But Ronan Finn is getting older as well, so you wouldn't be guaranteed that he'd have the legs of previous years. So some of their key players have either left or are getting on a little bit. It'll put a lot of emphasis now on Dylan Watts to come in and play a bigger role. Gary O'Neill now becomes a really important player for them. It's not like it's a crisis or anything like that. And I think Stephen Bradley said the other day that they'll likely bring maybe one other player in. But I think it's given a lot of hope to other teams. And, you know, it's a shame that there's still kind of doubt about the league and even talk that there won't be crowds this season, which I think is sad, really. There's a long, long way to go in this whole crisis. And if there are crowds, I think they'll really enjoy the league this season. I think Bowes have made some really interesting signings. Dundalk are kind of hard to call, but they've goal scorers, unlike a lot of teams such as Pats, who've made good signings but have lost McNally and obviously have problems up front. I still think Rovers will win the league, but it's looking a lot more open, I think, with McAniff and Jack Byrne gone.
Daniel, I see Michael Duffy might be now cleared to play for the Republic of Ireland.
Yeah, well, he's it's taken a couple of years for it to go through. I'm not really sure. I think that the fear Michael Duffy would have, you know, hopefully not for his sake, is that he might have missed his chance. Just purely in the sense that there's been times where Stephen Kenny definitely wanted to call him up in autumn, and I think there's every chance he would have gotten the pitch, but he couldn't because his clearance hadn't come through. And obviously, if all the squad are available to Stephen Kenny are fit, I think Duffy would need to be like an exceptional form to get into it. I don't think that's an unfair thing to say. It's just, you know, I've been watching a bit of Burnley Brighton today. Okay, Aaron Connolly's playing more century now, playing the Premier League, and we have reasonable options in wide areas, playing sort of at a better level at the moment. So Duffy would need to be doing exceptionally good, but. I mean, he is available now. So at least, you know, if he does start the season in good form, I mean, Kenny is a big admirer of him and knows what he can do. So maybe he's not a million miles away if all goes to plan. I mean, like McAniff is another one who, I suppose, was previously, Northern Ireland would prefer if McAniff was playing for them too. And Duffy is one in that bracket. But McAniff's move is interesting because. I think it's a very relevant point at the moment that, I think Hearts wanted him anyway. He's a good player, and I think he would have been in demand at any time. But there's definitely something going on in the transfer market in England with Brexit and Scotland, the UK generally, that I think there's a lot more interest in the Irish market now because it's very complicated to get players in. who aren't like top class, you know, established internationals into the UK game. So what you're going to find is that like Aaron McInniff is 20, like he's 25. And maybe in the past, there wouldn't have been too many lads of that age who left the league here. But I think it's going to happen a lot more. And particularly the success of Jamie McGrath and Conor McCarthy at St Mirren, I think that's probably helped. I think McInniff would have gone anyway, but I think what you'll find is there's going to be a lot more interest on players in the league here now because the transfer situation across the water has really changed. And so even someone like Michael Duffy now, who's that bit older, I think he's 26, he wouldn't have to do a huge amount to... I mean, he had a bit of interest before he signed a new contract with Dundalk, but he wouldn't have to do a huge amount more, I think, to come onto the radar. So it's definitely an interesting time for players here. That like Brexit actually might just finally might be some winners from Brexit, which might be sort of Irish professionals in their mid 20s who are getting better. McInniff is certainly one who's in that bracket.
I mean, a great day for Willie Mullins at the Dublin Racing Festival. He's won the bumper, Kilcrouche 11-10 favourite with Patrick, his son, on board. So four winners for Willie, including Shaquan Persois at Leopardstown this afternoon. Conor Harran and great guns at Swansea, another goal last night, 3-3. Your fellow Cork man, David, and putting himself in Stephen Kenny's shop window again?
Well, I think he deserves to be in it anyway, yeah. Regardless. I think the only concern would have been, which Conor would know, is that he wasn't playing regular football. He had a tough time at Aston Villa. He wasn't getting in. Of course, look, they signed Ross Barkley, who kind of filled that void. And look, Conor, to be fair to him, he's always been that. If you look throughout, like, his career path, he goes to Plymouth, plays, Barnsley plays, then he goes to Villa under Steve Bruce, plays, and he's kind of hit the point now where probably in the first time in his career, he hadn't played a large chunk of football, but he decides, I need to go on loan, I need to play, I want to be playing. I saw his interview last night where he says, you know, a career is too short, and he's not wrong. And look, he's gone into Swansea. I think he's 3-4 now, doesn't he? It's been it's very good for him. And look, I look at it, of course, look, I've known Conor probably 15, 16 years. It's great to see him doing well, but it stands good for Ireland that he's playing regular football. Because the goals he scored are all quality strikes, albeit there was one free kick. I can't give him too much credit because he's probably crossed it and it's gone in. But it's good for Ireland, it's good for Conor, and I'm happy for him.
That when he was at Barnsley, he was exceptional. Like he was like a dominant player in that team, and like at Villa, he never really had that dominance as such. Like he was a very, he was always a sort of a established squad there. And listen, he was very good at times, like in their promotion season and helping them stay up last year. But he was never necessarily like a main man there in the sense that they were, you know, like Grealish obviously had that almost role there at Villa, you know, and like John McGinn and. At times, he probably had to, you know, he had to learn to be even a bit more of a defensively minded player there a bit. But you sort of see it at Swansea now. It almost looks like he can become that sort of presence for them, like their real talismanic figure. I mean, they are now, again, the automatic promotion places. That was a huge win last night against Norwich, who were top, albeit with more games played. So it could well be one of those where it's a step back to make two forward because... I don't know where things are going to stand. I know Villa didn't really want to let him go. Like he was on the bench every week. You know, he actually sort of forced it himself. But so I don't know. Like if Swansea went up, is it an automatic that he would just go there? But it could actually give him the chance to almost be seen in a different light because just to be sort of someone central to a team getting promoted, it could really could almost elevate him. And like I know he's 30 this year. But he's still, he strikes me as a fellow who looks after himself. So he's going to be around for a while yet. And yeah, as David says, like he does have Irish competition. And if he hadn't been playing since November, he would have been in bother. I wouldn't have thought he'd be in too much bother now.
Caoimhin Kelleher has started the other night, David, for Liverpool. Would you have him ahead of Darren Randolph in those World Cup qualifiers?
It's inevitable that he's going to take over from Darren eventually. That is probably the big question. Does he do it now or does he not? I think Darren has been, you know, a terrific servant for Ireland over the years with his level of performances. It's a tough one. I suppose Darren has that experience over him. At the same time, Darren isn't, you know, he's not playing regularly and Caoimhin, albeit won't play as much. it's a tough one. I think Stephen will probably lead with Darren. I'd probably say stick with Darren, but there's no doubt that Caoimhin is coming for that number one shirt. And I think Darren will be well aware that he eventually will lose it to him. But it's nice to know that you've got a young keeper in Caoimhin that's coming. He's fantastic with his feet. I remember when Martin first brought him into the squad. Obviously, I know his older brothers. I knew his late father. I know the family. So I was excited to see what he's about. And, you know, he was excellent. And he definitely will be. Once he does get the number one shirt, he'll be in the goal for Ireland for a long time.
We got text in here earlier on the social media debate. David spoke brilliantly about it after four, and we'll get it back in the podcast if you've missed it, folks listening out there. What a legend David Meyler is. So well said. We need our boys to grow up to be men like him. That's one of our textures. And lads, re-social media, why in the name of God do people think their opinion needs to be shared with anybody outside of their friends? Social media friends or followers are strangers. Your opinion or their opinion does not matter. So why do you feel the need to put it out there? It's just attention seeking on both parts, as far as I'm concerned, says Deck in Galway. Well, I'd say apart from that, Deck, abusing people horrifically on social media is unacceptable and needs to be stamped out, and it needs to be action taken seriously by governments and social media companies. Johnny, we didn't get your opinion on this before the break. Do you want to come in on this?
Yeah, like, I suppose for the likes of Twitter and Facebook, you know, trying to have a situation where they can kind of cut out any sort of abuse or that it's essentially kind of like trying to, you know, brush the sea back from the ocean shore. Like, it's just so much there, and that it is kind of free speech. My idea of an alternative to Twitter would be, as one of the lads said, that you'd have to verify your account, and maybe that there's a system where everyone takes ownership, where you might like check a message to verify it yourself, just a random message as you log in and say, yeah, I actually think that's okay. And stuff like that would help to kind of cut out the nonsense, because I'll be honest, JD, I'm off social media now. Like, I just found it like absolutely septic at times last year. I remember like I'd gone to see my father in hospital one day in Tala during lockdown, and I came back and I'd made a comment about Liverpool a week previously that was put up on social media, and I just got a load of abuse. And it was just one of those days where I just couldn't take it. And maybe the abuse was like kind of, it was, well, you know, maybe it was justified in some respects, or maybe the criticism was justified, but some days you just can't take it anymore. And I when I went off social media, what I thought was strange was when people started texting me, they juxtaposed being off social media with a concern for my welfare. And I didn't know what to make of that. I was like, so the fact that I've gone off social media is an implication that I might be unwell or something. I was like, what does that say? Because you don't need to really be on social media to exist. And I also reflected on the fact that, like, I put up stuff on social media. Twitter is kind of dangerous because you can say things that, you know, it's kind of like that that line about, you know, a lie being halfway around the world before the truth can have time to put on its shoelaces. Something you say on Twitter can be all over, like, the Twitter sphere before you've even really thought about it yourself, because things happen instantly and all that. And I probably fell into that trap a lot, but I didn't even like what I was becoming on Twitter. You know, I was putting up stuff that in hindsight I probably shouldn't have put up. So I decided, like, I'd just go off social media, and I haven't missed it at all. And
do you feel better for it, Johnny? Do you feel better for being off?
Like, I went off Instagram as well, but like it was a situation on Instagram where I was putting up photos, and I was like, well, like, am I enjoying the situation here, or do I just want to put up a photograph from Instagram? I'm like 37 or 38 years of age at this stage. I'm like, why am I doing this? And you see, Twitter is very, very addictive. Now, it's not all bad by any means. You mentioned Rashford, and it can be very useful. There's no doubt about that. But it's a dangerous place, because the way Twitter works with algorithms and the way that it's kind of structured, it's basically convenient for Twitter to feed your timeline with people who agree with you. So it can be really, really troubling electoral results, where there's just a load of misinformation online. But basically, that's just fed to people because it kind of suits the way that the social media giant works. But like, when you're getting older, or if you're coming to the end of your days, you are not going to be like, oh geez, I had a great time on social media, you know, I had such great memories of social media. If I were to give advice to people in general, pretty much every single one of us, we all spend far too much time on our phones. And phones have become like basically everything now. They're our bank, they're our sat nav, you know, they're we're always on media, email, WhatsApp, everything. We're always in our phone. People will go to bed at night and the last thing they'll see is their phone rather than their partner. The first thing they'll see in the morning is their phone rather than their partner. Then they'll see their partner, but they'll basically be on the phone first. Go off your phone more, like maybe cut it down 50% if you can. And by extension, just have a think about social media. Does it make you happier? I don't think it does. I think it's a bit of a rat race, to be honest. And like, I don't miss it at all. And I'm conscious of the fact that as a journalist, like it was a great ability for me to like give a message out there or promote my articles or all that. But like, it was funny. Like, I honestly haven't missed it at all. And I'd imagine a lot of people don't miss me on it as well.
I miss you, Johnny. I miss you. I miss the Whiznail and I humour, and obviously the great tipping that you do and the original insight. So I do miss you off social media, Johnny, I have to say.
Yeah, I just think that thanks for that, JD. And the Whiznail and I stuff, that stuff goes on WhatsApp. But like, it is just a last note on this. M. Malone had a lovely piece this week about it's 10 years since the book that was written about Robert Enke. I forget the name of the journalist now, but
Robert Ring.
So it was a really interesting piece because Robert was talking about the fact that like he was in a situation where this book was selling really well, and you know it was kind of an awkward situation because he didn't want to profit from something, and it was a fascinating article, but it did get me thinking. Like, Robert Enke was going through absolute horror in his life, and he was still able to sort of perform. Like, he wasn't actually playing that badly the time that he died. And I remember like being so struck by that book. And I remember looking, there was a photo when he went to Turkey. There was a photo of him at the press conference in Istanbul. And if ever a photo told of a man who was in absolute inner agony, he was just this pained expression of horrific, horrific depression. And then his daughter died, and all these horrible things happened in his life. Can you imagine if Robert Enke were around today and had a bad game, the abuse he'd get on Twitter?
Yeah, well said, Johnny. I joined Twitter 10 and a half years ago. I found it very positive, refreshing. It was great fun. You'd interact with people, you'd share opinions. And then in the last years, as David was saying earlier on, everything has become negative. Now, we've been through financial crisis, we've been through populism, we've been through this horrendous, wretched pandemic, but it's just got toxic. It has got, on the whole, I think a lot of it has got toxic. I even know myself going to Cheltenham last year, dogs abuse, absolute dogs abuse for doing my job. And you're kind of thinking to yourself, is it worth it? And the way I compartmentalize it, I treat anything negative on Twitter as spam, like a spam email. But not everybody, it definitely got to me. I remember I was in tears at Cheltenham last year, the final day, like I couldn't deal with that anymore. But I just kept going. I said, okay, I'm not going to let these people give me grief, win the argument on this. And I'm just going to keep going on Twitter. So I do see the positives, and I do see the positives in people. Most people are sound, but unfortunately, a lot of people out there are not. And they're the people generally that wouldn't say boo to you on the street. And that's my two cents in it. Just before we go, David Meyler, Man United, Everton tonight, 8 o'clock start. I hope to see Cavani play. I love watching Cavani. The 9-0 win, it's not going to be 9-0 against Everton, but do you expect United to do it?
Ooh, it's another big game for them. You know, they had the result against Liverpool. They kind of kicked on, obviously, with Southampton, where the Southampton fell apart. It's probably the game now where they're kind of really going to cement themselves in that top four, in my opinion, that they're kind of like, we're above Everton. Everton are kind of flirting with the, you know, the Europa League spots kind of down that direction. Look, you can kind of tell that their best front three is Cavani. I want to see him play. He's a wonderful player. He has been for many years. And I think, you know, Solskjaer's trying to get the best out of him. And I think he'll improve Rashford, Greenwood and Martial in terms of his movement, his understanding of the game. Because, like, you know, someone like Martial is probably struggling for confidence. Now, we could go off another debate about, you know, the abuse he'll be receiving. But in a sense, no, I think United should have too much, but then I imagine Seamus will end up seeing this and give me some stick. So I hope Seamus scores or plays well.
I'd say he's loving playing for Ancelotti, is he, David?
Yeah, no, I speak to Seamus regularly. I've spoken many times on my admiration for the fella, someone I trust in. He said it's different. You know, I remember I spoke to him before Marco Silva came in. Obviously, I had dealings with him at Hull, and Seamus was very excited, and that didn't work out. And now I'm racking Seamus's brain about Ancelotti because I was a massive fan of, you know, the Milan team he was in charge of. round of 5.07, 5.08 around that time. Big, you know, fantastic players. You've seen what he's achieved. You want to know what he's like. And Seamus said it's a breath of fresh air the way he is. You can go speak to him. He's just kind of a great man manager, and he speaks so highly of him.
Lads, Seamus Coleman's got to be in that team, hasn't he, in March? Like, just from a leadership point of view, to get the ground, the foundations laid for this new, hopefully the second coming of Stephen Kenny and Ireland.
You would think there's a very good chance, particularly the first game being Serbia away. And I know David spoke about Darren Randolph earlier. That's probably, why Randolph, presuming he's fit, which is the only thing, I think the only issue with Randolph is that he's not fit at the moment. And I think, like, wear and tear is possibly a concern, but you would think that the experience would be a factor that would get Coleman, because Doherty's had a very uncertain year. And the fact is, there's three games in that window. There's home games, against Luxembourg and Qatar coming up. Okay, the Qatar one's irrelevant. The Luxembourg one matters. And you could almost, like, Coleman now, you'll see, doesn't play every week at Everton either. And I kind of wonder, would it be Coleman for Serbia and maybe Doherty for that game at home to Luxembourg? I wouldn't be surprised if it did something like that.
All right, guys, we've got to leave it there. David Meyler, Dan McDonald, Johnny Ward. I'll just give you some text to finish. Solution to Twitter, charge 1 cent or a penny per tweet. Goodbye, trolls. That's guaranteed from Colin. And a great conversation by the Saturday panel. Completely agree with Johnny coming off social media. A toxic place. Keep up the good work, lads. That's from Mark and Beaumont. Lads, take care.
Thanks, JD.
Thanks, guys.
Okay, we'll be joined by David Meyler, Dan McDonald and Johnny Ward again very soon. I'll just give you some scores from the Premier League. Aston Villa 1, Arsenal 0, Burnley 1, Brighton 1. That is now is that a latest or is that a full-time? It is a full-time. Burnley and Brighton drawing into the closing stages of, injury time now. Newcastle 3, Southampton 2 at St James' Park. Really important win for Newcastle. Coming up now with Jeff Hendrick sent off in that game. In Scotland as well, we got match on Celtic playing there in Scotland. And what is the score? 2-1 win for Celtic over Motherwell. So welcome win for Neil Lennon. Not going to win them the title, but Welsh and Edward scoring the goals as Celtic beat Motherwell by 2-1. So the Championship, Coventry City 0, Watford 0 is a full-time from earlier on. Bournemouth 3, Birmingham 2 is the latest score. It's Bristol City 0, Cardiff City 2, Luton Town 1, Huddersfield 1, Middlesbrough 1, Brentford 4, Millwall 4, Sheffield Wednesday 1 right now in the closing stages. Preston North End 1, Rotherham United 2. It is QPR 1, Blackburn Rovers 0, Stoke City 0, Reading 0, and Wickham 0, Nottingham Forest 3. Dustin Johnson's got a two-shot lead after the third round of the Saudi International on 13 under par. Shaq and Persuad and Honeysuckle, the big winners at the Dublin Racing Festival today. Willie Mullins with 4 winners on the card, and France thumping Italy by 50 points to 10 in the Six Nations Championship. England and Scotland just kicked off at Twickenham. So don't forget Off the Ball Sunday tomorrow. It starts at 1 o'clock. I'll be sitting in for Joe Molloy. 2 live and exclusive Premier League commentary games to bring you. Nathan Murphy and Damien Delaney calling the shots for one of the biggest games of global football. Champions Liverpool playing Manchester City at Anfield. Also showcasing the game involving Wolves and Leicester City. Stephen Doyle and Brian Kerr calling the shots for that one. Johnny Murphy will also give us take on the Six Nations opener between Ireland and Wales. We're bringing the Sunday paper review on our social channels. Cliona Foley and Bernard Jackman going to pick out the best stories from 11:30, so it's going to be a brilliant show. Be sure to tune into that. Now, if you missed our special Six Nations preview on the Saturday panel with Keith Wood, Jonathan Davies and Mike McCarthy, or any of OTB Football Saturday with David Meyler, Dan McDonald and Johnny Ward, you'll be able to find the podcasts of our content on the OTB Sports app. Search OTB Sports in your app store now to download the app for iOS and Android, or listen back wherever you get your pods. Thanks so much for listening this afternoon. Speak tomorrow. Bye-bye.